Hello, comic book fans. Here's Earl Grey. And today I want to talk about Velvet, which I've binged just yesterday from cover to cover in one day. 15 issues. And I had, I think, a different reading experience than those of you who read that in single issues over 3 years. I can't even imagine how it is to read such a story with these interruptions of months or 2 months at one go. So, for me, it was a very satisfying read, very gripping, very fun read. Hey, it's Brubaker. What else do you guess? And of course, it's a good story. Our James Bond character here from the start gets killed right on the first pages, and Miss Moneypenny, aka Velvet Templeton, takes over. And that's the main pitch, Miss Moneypenny. So to speak, goes rogue. And so we have this James Bond over-the-top action. She flies around a lot and fights a lot, maybe a bit too much for me. Sometimes they are fighting situations where she stands against four guys and she knocks them out without effort. Sometimes she is pushed to her limits, of course. But it's a bit the same feel you get sometimes with James Bond movies. In my case, it's the feeling, oh, I'm too old for that. But it's not just that, this over-the-top action fun. But it's a serious portray of this lady here, and yeah, and you get a lot of character moments, and it's a lot of double crossing and twists and so on. To the end, a bit too much. The end is a bit too convoluted. Still somehow satisfying, but there are some open plot questions that aren't really solved in my book. I won't give, don't want to give anything away here, you see. There are so many cars flipping upside down, crashing. Yeah, if you're in this kind of thing, and why you shouldn't be. There's a lot of that stuff and hitting and kicking and all that good stuff. The political frame or references in the second or third part of the book are a bit lost to me. They are interesting and root this in that time period, but there are so much open questions just for me that I'm not really satisfied with it. I mean, if you put some of these characters into a story, you have to do a bit more with them, in my opinion. I don't want to spoil anything, so I don't drop names, but I guess you will have heard of that, what I'm talking about. Okay, anyhow, as to the art. Obviously amazing, obviously fitting, very realistic for that sort of story, even though I'm not so surprised how realistic Steve Epting's art is because, hey, he's obviously heavily photo-referencing here, almost tracing through photos, I think. To a point, on some panels that I think, okay, if I really would call it a drawing, it's, yeah, tracing and adding and doing photos, manipulating some photos. So it's, yeah, in the end, it's a drawing, obviously. And I don't want to be too critical, but of course, it wouldn't have functioned as well if there wouldn't be the amazing coloring of Elizabeth Breitweiser. She does an, again, amazing job, again, because in the Fade Out, the other Ed Brubaker book that came out recently, she did a similar tremendous coloring job. Maybe she's my favorite colorist nowadays. So, but then you have these very realistic, maybe sometimes too realistic stuff here. I saw reviews of Velvet where the obvious comparison to Sean Phillips turns up, and some people redeem would prefer Steve Epting above Sean Phillips, and I don't agree with that because, okay, Sean Phillips sometimes gets some at anatomy details wrong or some proportions, but that's his drawing, and I can feel his drawing. I can feel his, yeah, his hand in that. Steve Epting is almost too perfect for me, and some panels here really took me out of it because when you see this panel, there's nothing too wrong with it. But look at her face. Yeah, you can almost most see the photo behind the drawing. And this is some sort somehow a bit creepy, and I read this page here and then I stared some minutes on this photo, on this, sorry, drawing, of course. I know you may say I'm too critical about this art because it's clearly above average, maybe one of the best art you can come around with in comic book form, of course. And again, of course, that's due a lot to Elizabeth Breitweiser. Look at this, these color effects here. And on the other hand, look at this page here. Is it a photo? Is it a drawing? Yeah. And by the way, this dude here is some so superfluous. He is a bit of comical relief, I think, in a way. Typical pose for Velvet here. Wait, I have to show you. This is pretty funny. Ed Brubaker makes has his, it's fun with this guy here and indulging in any espionage, superhero, super spy cliche that he can find. It's the start, or it was the start of the third soft cover trade. So, yeah, I'm losing a bit of track here. The art, maybe 8 of, or 9 out of 10 stars, maybe. Story writing as well, 9 out of 10 stars. So you can see it's a very, very decent, very, very decent book here. Another thing that, in my opinion, did Sean Phillips better than Steve Epting was the way he was open about it in the Fade Out hardcover trade, where he showed some of the photo references and was pretty open about that. Steve Epting just gives here some thumbnails and then the finished art, and I guess he leaves out the most important step in his process. doing the photos, after which he traces his actual drawings. And of course, here, the coloring of Elizabeth Breitwiser. And I would be really curious how he did that. It's not just to diminish his working process, because it's just impossible, I think, to do these precise drawings without any photographic template or references. It's not really possible. And yeah, but I would be curious to see some photos from her and the other actors who were photographed for this book. So, and I think it would be fair to give them some credits. Why not? Yeah. Instead, you find in the back matter section a lot of pondering about female action heroes, especially in espionage movies, I think. I had another comparison, and this is an old, pretty old German comic. Lozier's, I guess his name is Philippe. Hey, Gérard Lozier, here you see him in his prime. This book is from 1988, so you can guess that he's looking this way back then. And Deadly Lily here is, it's a fun book. And she's tough as nails, I guess you think you would call her, and she's sexually very liberated and fights like the best and the toughest man, and there are some signature moves here on this page that I found again in the Velvet comic. Of course, the style is in a completely different style, but yeah, this comic is highly recommended. The more so if you're one of my European viewers, at least the German ones here are very dirt cheap to get everywhere. I think they overprinted just the run, so there are lots of these Deadly Lily books around. And I guess in France or somewhere else you can get the French original. And my is a bit loose, as you can see here. But for the amount of reading I did with this book, it's in pretty good shape. So I stop with the rambling here. Thanks for listening and watching. Goodbye.